Well, hello, church. I'm Cory DeForest. I'm the preaching pastor out at the Napa location. And some of you may think, if you've been watching our videos over the last few weeks, you may be thinking, hey, did I accidentally skip over and just go straight to the communion video? I just want to pause you real quick and say, no, you're not at the communion portion of this video. You're actually at the preaching portion. This week, Tony and I are switching it up, and I'm doing the message part, and he's doing the communion part of the video. And so I'm excited. I'm excited to preach, and I'm excited to share with you what God has put on my heart and what God is doing. And but before we get to that, if you've ever been at the Napa location, you know that I love announcements. And so I thought, because maybe I've missed the ability to be able to do them, you've probably missed out on us being able to do them, I thought I'd do a few for you and just, you know, try to get back to some of the normalcy in some of those areas. But just a few things that are not normal announcements. The first thing is that we just want to say, if you've been watching, you've been sharing this with other people, we just want to say thank you. Thank you for being with us each and every week and letting us know how this is continually being a blessing in your life. We're just grateful that we know this is a different medium than how we would normally do and meet. And so we just want to say thank you for continually being with us each and every week and participating in that. Second thing is that we also know that there are some of you out there that have been watching that we've never met and maybe never even crossed into one of the buildings in Napa or Warrenton before. But yet you're watching and you're sharing and you're experiencing some of this, of that as we experience it. And we just want to say thank you to you also, and that we can't wait to meet you. Hopefully one day as the doors are open, we hope that we can share with you the fullness of some of why we gather and when we gather, and hope that you would be willing to introduce yourselves to us. We had actually hoped that you would introduce yourself before that. That if, like today, you're watching this and we've never met you, we would love it if you took a second at some point, send us an email and say, hey, I've never been to your church, but I'm watching. This is how I feel. This is what's going on. And we would love to know how we could be praying for you. But we would love to be able to introduce ourselves. And a way that we can do that as well is that we would love it if you took a minute. Two is to go to our website, cconline.cc, and there you'll be able to get to know some of us a little bit and get to know what we believe and see some of the experiences that we have, and just kind of a basic introduction to our church is on there. But really, there is no introduction without the people. And so we invite you to that when we're able to gather together once again, whenever that is, we would love to be able to meet you in person. We would love to be able for you to know and get to know the people that sit in these chairs with us. And so we would love for you to take that time when that happens. Lastly, many of you know, if you've been following along with our videos, is that we are in Core 52, the daily devotional. 52 of the core verses in the Bible that help us, that God has used to tell his story and share to us what he is doing and what he has done. And I just kind of always want to take a minute for myself to help us remind ourselves that in no way as a church, as we go through this devotional, do we ever take another book but written by another man to be equated to the Word of God. And Core 52 is an awesome tool for us as a church, and we've been seeing so many good things happening with it, and so we're excited as we continue to go through it. But we always just want to flatly say we don't think it is an add-on to the Word of God. It's any comparable to the Word of God. It's not. It's a tool to get us to the Word of God and get us to make sure that we know what God is doing in there. And so if you don't have that book, we would love for you to get one. And so email us, ccwarrentonnapa@gmail.com. We would be happy to send you one or leave one for you somewhere. Just got to let us know. But also, if you're also looking to interact in other ways with the book and with the material, you could go to Mark Moore's, the author's website at core52.org. It's free to sign up. It's free to use. And it has there's great resources on there as you read, as you memorize, as you get into scripture. It's an amazing resource that we would love for you to take advantage of. And lastly, we are starting this week going to be trying to do a virtual, quote unquote, as I call it, small group with the whole church. And each and every person if you are part of this church, are invited to be a part. And what this looks like is that we're just going to interact with the material week by week and share what God is doing in our hearts through this material, what we're learning, some things that we maybe have missed before, or just in generalities, we just want to talk about these things and what God is doing in our lives as we are separated right now. And we seem like we could be missing some of that togetherness that could be happening. And so we are excited to start this Facebook small group, but also every Thursday I'm going to go live on our YouTube page to kind of open up the discussion. And as we ask live questions and as we just talk and are a part, but also if you are in need of prayer, we're going to take some time to make sure that we are praying for you and for you in any way that you are needing through this time. And so we just want to invite you, if that's something that you are interested in and would love an invite to the Facebook group, please, again, email us, ccwarrentonnapa@gmail.com, or get in touch with me, Cory DeForest, or Tony, and we'd be happy to get you involved. That being said, we are continuing our series, week 18, in Core 52, titled Blessedness. And as you will interact, if you haven't already, you'll interact with the material, you'll see Mark Moore kind of take this chapter and this idea of blessedness and really kind of take it in a way that is more towards understanding blessedness in the eyes of persecution. Whether it's the core verse, which is Matthew 5:11-12 says, Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. And so we have this core verse, we have the chapters that he's going to go through, and it talks a lot about persecution. The where it comes to a little bit of a head is that the story text is John 3:4. And as you read John 3:4, which we'll read part of, John 3:4 don't talk about persecution. But they do talk about this understanding is how can you and I live a life that is what God would consider blessed in the midst. And so the truth that we're going to get to this morning or this evening, whenever you're watching this, is that this is going to hopefully help, no matter whether you're being persecuted or maybe today, maybe things are going well for you right now. Things are going really good. And we need to be able to identify, is this a true blessing or is this not a blessing? Is this a blessing that is not from God, but rather is a worldly blessing and it feels good? Or maybe right now you're in a place that could be pretty dark. As we know, as this virus thing kind of keeps going on, we know more and more people are losing their jobs or not being able to pay their car payment or their mortgage or their rent or losing their jobs and not being able to get funds into their account as quickly as they hope. And repercussions are just going out. And you're saying, how can I be blessed now? Is it possible? Is it possible that I can somehow be blessed in this time when it seems like the world is falling around me and it seems like the world is hopeless? It seems it's bleak and not ever going to get any better. And my hope this during this time is that we will be able to answer that with a resounding yes, with a hopeful and joyful yes, because we'll get to see what God has done for us. And you have to excuse me if I laugh or joke or make a statement when I think of the word blessed. As a millennial, this word kind of has taken on its own identity in a way in our culture, especially if you're a part of the social media culture. If you are part of Facebook or Instagram, if you're like me who started social media way back into the MySpace era, blessing is completely different than what we see in Scripture. Blessing is, my house is nice. I have a wife. I have 3 kids. I have a nice 2 nice cars. I have a job. And every year we go on a beach, a hot, sunny beach vacation. And then when I think about it, I think of #blessed. Or if you're a little bit older than me, you think of the phone, #blessed. And so it kind of has taken on its life of its own. As we see all over social media, what does, if I were to look at social media and think, this is what a blessed life looks like, what happens when that all crumbles? What happens when that is no longer the life that you see and have anymore? Can we be blessed? And the main question we're going to answer is, what does it mean to be truly blessed? What does it look like to regain the identity of this word and what God has for us through it? And so if you want to turn with me, you can, to John chapter 3, which is where we're going to pick up. And in John chapter 3, it's most famous for John 3:16, an amazing verse, a great verse, absolutely. But there's a big portion of this verse that we have to understand and see what God is doing for us from the very beginning. What we're going to see here is Jesus having a conversation with a man named Nicodemus. And Nicodemus is a Pharisee. And if you lived in the first century in Jerusalem, Nicodemus would be the epitome of what a blessed man looked like, because as a Pharisee, you were a teacher of the law, you're a protector of the law. People wanted to be you, people wanted to talk with you, people wanted to know you, people wanted to be able to say they were friends with you, and that you were learning from them, and that they were able to teach you, and you could one day brag to your friends, this man was able to, that took me under his wing and taught me these things, and I saw him do these things. They were the blessed. And now what we see is this man coming to Jesus with some questions and some concerns and some ideas. This is what he says in John chapter 3, verse 1. He says, "Now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, 'Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him.'" See, these words kind of seem like Nicodemus is giving some good, sincere, you are doing good in this community. You're a man that is doing God's work. You're doing what God has asked you to do. And I think Nicodemus is sincere. I don't think he's trying to trick Jesus or try to get him to do things. I don't think that that's the case. But really, here's some sincere words, Jesus. You're doing the Lord's work. And that's great and all, but this is what Jesus says. He says, Jesus answered him in verse 3, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Jesus completely skips the pleasantries and says, "Hey, Nicodemus, hey, you're a Pharisee. You are a man of the law. You know the law. You teach the law. Here's what you need to know in this life, is that you need, your greatest need in this life is to be born again. That's it. You need to know what it's like to be in the kingdom of God. You need to know what it's like to be on Jesus' side." Because what the reality is Jesus is talking and teaching here is that we have to understand that there is this world side and there is the kingdom of God side. And there's only one way to a blessed life that God is trying to continuously give us. And that is only in the kingdom of God with Jesus. And the only way to do that is to be born again. And we'll get more into understanding what it means to be born again. But he says here, Nicodemus says to him, and I love this and hate this about it as he says this. He says, "How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born?" In my mind, is Jesus is as God is knows the role of Nicodemus in the temple. In my mind, I think Nicodemus or Jesus says, "What are you thinking? Like, of course not. And of course an old man cannot be reborn in the ideas of the physicalness and understanding that we understand birth. Not possible. That is not that you're thinking in the ideas of physically rather than spiritually." And it's no fault to Nicodemus in a way, is they thought their salvation was very much their born again salvation was going to be physically, not spiritually. And yet what Jesus says is that this is not... Are you kidding? He says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes and you hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. Jesus is probably nicer in that moment than many of us would be. Like, are you kidding, Nicodemus? Like, that's ridiculous. But Jesus says, no, I'm going to tell you again. And you need to hear this. I say to you, unless one is born of water and spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. Jesus says, there is a line in the sand to be had. In order to experience this life, this kingdom, this salvation, this understanding of peace and hope and true joy and blessedness, to be happy, truly happy, is to be born again. Is to choose and trust and believe and follow and obey Jesus with everything that we have. The cost is great. But if we want this life, if we want this understanding, if we want this idea of a blessed life, and I'm not talking of a blessed life when it comes to the physicalness of what we have, own, gather, any of that. But we want something in our lives that is unchanging, that is full of goodness and grace and peace and hope. If you want that, Jesus says, the way to it is me. To be born again. And he says, Nicodemus said to him, how can these things be? Thinking physically rather than spiritually. Jesus answered him, are you the teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Truly, truly, I say to you. Jesus, again, when he says truly, truly, he's emphasizing, he is exclamation point over and over and over again. Truly, truly, listen to my words. I'm begging you. I'm imploring you. Listen to what I am saying here. I say to you, we speak of what we know and bear witness to what we have seen, but you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you of heavenly things? If I tell you of the things of the world and you don't believe them, of the physical and you don't, how are you going to understand the spiritual? No one has ascended into heaven except he who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. And Jesus says that basically he's telling him, as he calls him and talks about himself as the Son of Man, which we've already talked about in previous videos and weeks. Jesus says, no, we have to understand that our ability to experience this blessedness and is to be able to experience it now and today. Because as that whoever believes in him, Jesus, talking about himself, may have eternal life. It says the most beautiful blessing you can have is to know your eternity is set. And it's not just set after you die, but it is today. And then you can experience it today, and you can live in it today, and you can walk in it today. As he says, as one author, as I was reading and preparing, said, an infinitely high quality of life, living in fellowship with God both now and forever. Blessing is an infinitely high quality of life, living in fellowship with God both now and forever. To experience blessed and to be blessed and to live in a blessing is not gathering and getting things, but it is to know and to walk in and spirit and truth with the living God today. And forever, and to know forever is set. To be blessed is to live in fellowship with God, or to experience that blessedness is to continually live in fellowship with God. That is blessedness. To fellowship with him. And the thing is that he desires it. He desires that life for you and I together. That is his whole, this would, the scripture is telling us as Jesus is being sent. And that's what we get to in John 3:16 and following. Let's read it. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment. The light has come into the world, and people love the darkness rather than the light, because their works were evil. For everyone who does wicked things hates the light and does not come to the light, lest his works should be exposed. But whoever does this, what is true, comes to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that his works have been carried out in God. And so this is what Jesus is trying to tell us and tell Nicodemus as he's sitting there with him. And it's so important and so foundational to our understanding, whether you are a believer in Jesus or maybe today you are watching and you haven't put your faith and trust in Jesus. Here's the fundamental idea that we have to understand and about who God is. As we read John 3:16, for God so loved the world. And a lot of times we think, man, universal, Earth, Mars, the planets and the stars and the galaxies and as they go on, God loves it all because he created it all. But rather he's speaking here to you and I, his greatest creation. The truth is that God loves you. God loves you. All of this for you and I to experience and to live in fellowship continually with him forever. And it was our sin and our brokenness that has caused that chasm to be had in this world. And yet, no, God knowing that we could never make that chasm any smaller. We could never get back to him on our own. There was nothing that we could ever do that could ever make it right. He did it. God made it right. In our worst of worst, he sent his son for us. He loves us that much. He cares for us that much. He desires us that much. And here's the lie that many of us maybe have fallen into in the past, or maybe you're right now, you're trying to get yourself out of it or don't know that it's there. God does not love some future version of you. He does not desire you more and more only when you become better and better. No, the experience, this fellowship with God is to fully receive and know and live in the truth that God's fullness and love has been poured out on and for you now. And for those who have put their trust in Jesus and have followed him and are living in that today and can live into that for eternity. But for you, maybe for you, maybe that maybe not putting your trust in him. Does that change anything? Because it should, in my heart, but long before I believed, it changes everything. Because in growing up in the church, it always seemed like you had to look, be, act, go to the right things, do the right things, be the right things, and God then will be accept you. And what we see here is that God's desire has always been to love you and for you to receive that love. His desire has never been to condemn you. And what he says in these verses is that there is going to be a point in history where that condemnation is going to have to come. But for the believer, for those who are in Jesus Christ, there is no condemnation, as Romans 8:1 says. So if you're ever feeling, as you fall in sin and feel like there's this idea of condemnation pouring over into your life, it's not the truth. You are not been condemned. Your condemnation has fallen on Jesus. And I was listening to another pastor that I appreciate, and he says, condemnation is from the enemy. When a believer feels or is living in an idea of condemnation in their life, that's from the enemy. And it is untrue, and it's not the truth about what God has said and how he is loving you today. But if you're feeling convicted now, that is of the Holy Spirit, and that is a gift of the Holy Spirit, as we feel convicted of our sin and brokenness and where we fall short and don't please the Lord, and that our actions, thoughts, and doings. But it's an opportunity, as we are convicted from the Holy Spirit, to walk with the Holy Spirit and to grow in the Holy Spirit and rely on the Holy Spirit and the truth of the Holy Spirit in our lives. And it's such a blessing. But we have to understand the condemnation is not ours. It's already been paid for, which is so crazy, because as I think about that, I have to ask, like, why would he do that? Who would do that? Who would send his only son to die for me? As a parent, and I'm imperfect, and I'm not God, I have one child. I would not send that child to die. Yet the perfect, loving, gracious, merciful God of the universe desires for us to know and walk in his love and our lives to change forever. So that whether it's persecution, so that when things just fall apart or seem like they're falling apart, when hope seems to be lost, when joy seems to be stolen, when shame seems to be coming in, when things seem to be broken, we ask ourselves, how can I, what does this mean? What is it? Can I be blessed? How can I, is it okay to be blessed in this time when it seems like that this is all falling around me? And that is the beauty about this life in Christ, is that this cannot be stripped away from you. It cannot be taken from you. It cannot be lost from you. It cannot, just as everything in this world can be, it seems like. And I'm not just talking about the stuff. I'm talking about the joy we feel in relationships and in people and things that we do and the joy we take in our work and our jobs. Those things can all be taken away from us. But the beauty of the gospel and the life of blessedness in Christ is that it can't be stripped away from you. And that's why this morning or this evening, whenever you're watching this, I implore you, if you haven't already, put your trust and faith in Jesus. As Jesus talks about, to get to the other side from the world to the kingdom and this life in Christ, he says, this is how it's done. He says, verse 15, that whoever believes in him. And we have to ask ourselves this today, do you believe that Jesus lived on this earth a perfect, holy, righteous life, free from sin, and that man went to the cross willingly and obediently to give up his life as a ransom to buy you back from our in slavery to sin, our in slavery to unforgiveness, and to buy us back on the cross by putting down his own life. Do you believe that? And if you do, verse 5 says, Jesus answered again, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and of spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. Then your next step right now, no matter if you say you put your trust in Jesus a long time ago or right today, if you say, yes, I believe that, I trust that, I want to put my faith and obedience into him because I want that life. I want something in my life that cannot be taken away from me. Then it is time to get baptized. It is time to put our trust and faith in him. Today. And so we implore you that when we talk about baptism, when we talk about this idea, as many other scriptures talk about, we are participating with Jesus in his life, death, and resurrection as we go into the water and out of the water. And there's nothing in the water or wherever it is done that can save you. But it is, as Peter says, it is our appeal to God. we are drawing, as we go back to that idea, we are drawing a line in the sand and saying, Jesus, I'm yours. Everything about me, every part of me, everything that is me and my identity is with nothing if it's not in you first. And so if that is you today, we ask that you find someone, ask someone, call us, email us today. And we'll make sure that we can work with you to get that done. The second thing is, if you are a believer in Jesus, and you have walking your life with him, and you know what we're talking about, this life, this thing that can't be stripped away from you, and somehow, even in the midst of this, and maybe you are already experiencing some of the effects of what is happening with this virus in your life, and you still feel like it hasn't affected your spirit, it hasn't affected your ability to love and care for people, and I'm so grateful for that, because I know that is in our community and that is in our church, that there are people that are loving and caring for people, and it is awesome. But here's where we have a great ability, is to not just live in that moment, but actually taking the moment and it being a blessing to people. So when the world seems dark, we bring the light, that we be the ones shedding the light of Jesus, just telling people and sharing with people and loving with people that there is a great blessing in Christ. That when the world seems hopeless, that we bring the hope, that we're not a part of the people that said that this world is hopeless and without any goodness, because we know it's untrue. We know it's not the truth and what God has asked us to know. But it also, when the world is starved for joy, we bring the joy. Are we down all the time, or are we in this moment givers of joy to those around us? Are we speaking joy, loving in joy, worshiping in joy in every part that we can? And then lastly, when the world is at odds and it doesn't know and things are falling apart and things are being stripped away and it's at odds with one another, and there's the left side and right side and top side and downside, whatever, are you as a believer buying into that? Or are you as a believer being the peacemaker you've been called to be? As Jesus is on the Sermon on the Mount, speaks the same words today. Blessed are the peacemakers. Are we instilling peace into this world where it seems like everybody wants it to be at odds with one another? That doesn't have to be us. It shouldn't be us. That's not living in this life that is a blessing from God. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you. We thank you for Jesus. We thank you for the ability to be able to live a life that is a blessing, no matter the circumstances, because we know, Lord, that it cannot be taken away from us. And that is only something that you can give. Lord, that it is only something that you can willingly give to us. And Lord, it is because you love us and desire for us to be in fellowship with you today and forever. And Lord, that is amazing. That is an amazing gift. And we want to thank you for that gift. Lord, if there's some that are watching this that are having a hard time receiving that, Lord, we ask that you soften their heart and that the Holy Spirit speak truth and not lie. Lord, we pray that we, as for those that are watching, that we believe walking in Jesus, Lord, may we be joy givers, peacemakers. Lord, may we be the light in our community, and we bring the hope that you have given us, because Jesus has overcome. And Lord, your truth and your word says that we will as well. Lord, we love you and we thank you and we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hello, church. Cory and I get to switch roles this week, which is nice. But for our time of communion, I want to encourage you, and I hope you did ahead of time, to go ahead and get whatever elements you're going to use to participate in our time of communion together, some form of bread, juice, whatever you have. Over and over again over the last, well, now 8 weeks during this situation, Cory has emphasized the seriousness of communion and what it is and what it means, and I want to echo those sentiments. Communion is a serious time. It's not something to take lightly. Paul warns us that it's a dangerous meal, as Cory has mentioned before. And if you don't have the right heart and you're not in the right mindset and spirit going into participating in communion, that it's not great. I'll just put it that way. And I kind of have to, I feel like I got to be a little bit of a meanie here, but I got to kind of call some of us out. When we go into communion, we need to have a repentant heart. That's part of what taking communion seriously means. That's what examining your heart means, is that the Holy Spirit is convicting you in such a way that you feel like turning away from your sin and turning toward God. Sometimes the challenge can be identifying those sins in our lives. Now, as this COVID-19 situation carries on and more of us and more of us and more of us become frustrated, anxious, stressed, and downright angry, I seem to be noticing, and I think other people are too, an uptick in language that's very inward focused and a little self-serving amongst Christians. And I probably just stepped on some toes. And I've probably just created a reaction from some that's like, well, what are you talking about? And that's exactly what I'm talking about. We have got to this point during this whole process where a lot of us are getting demanding of our way. And we want to do this, and I want to do this. And it's making me nervous as we participate in these things and reflect on Jesus is, that we are starting to care more about going back to a certain way of life than we are growing in our Christ likeness. I don't want to see this time wasted. And that might be a weird statement to say for a communion meditation. But as we draw into communion, there's something about Jesus and this, what this time represents, that's very important for us to remember. Is that he selflessly, in humility, sacrificed himself for the sake of other people. He was thinking about accomplishing the mission the Father gave to him of becoming the ransom for many, that he would become our sin, that he would take on all of our dirt, our baggage, everything that's evil within us, our pride, our anger, our jealousy, our lust, everything. And he would become that and hang on the cross in our place, suffer God's wrath, the punishment for sin in our place, so that we could be forgiven. And time again throughout the Bible, just like we talked about last week in the sermon, the Son of Man, that title being a title of humility, we see Jesus as a humble, meek, compassionate servant who gave up his life as a ransom for many. So I shared this passage in the sermon last week, and I need to share it again as we get ready to participate in communion. And it's from Philippians chapter 2. And it says this, and I'm going to back it up a little bit to the very first verse. And it says, so if there's any encouragement in Christ, any comfort from love, any participation in the Spirit, any affection and sympathy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourself. I have to repent of this every single day. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. before he's even mentioned the name Jesus Christ here in this chapter, he is preaching about Jesus Christ. If we claim to be Christians, if we claim to be disciples of Christ, that we have faith in Jesus, then this needs to be the characteristic that is on display all the time. That we do nothing out of selfish ambition or conceit, but we consider others and their needs and what's going on in their lives. And as this whole situation unfolds, there's a lot of I talk coming from the mouths of Christians who should be demonstrating the values and characteristics of Christ in their lives, in being selfless and humble and counting others as more significant than yourselves. He says, verse 4, let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, and being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. And that is what we remember when we celebrate communion together, is the humility of Christ most profoundly demonstrated through his self-sacrifice and becoming obedient even to the point of death on a cross. And so I want to ask every single one of us right now who are ready to participate in this, are we demonstrating with the way we think, the way we talk, and the way we act, that we are humble like Christ, that we consider others more significant than ourselves? Because I'll tell you right now, I don't do a great job of that. And I want to confess that so you don't feel like I'm yelling at you or trying to lecture you or anything like that. But we collectively as a people need to demonstrate this humility. And like I said before, like Corey's mentioned many times, this meal, this memorial service called communion is serious and a part of preparing our hearts to remember the humility and sacrifice of Jesus is to repent of our sin. And this is just something that I see is coming to the surface in so many of us as we demand to have our way and we demand our rights. Jesus laid down his rights so that you could get into heaven. So, in all seriousness, I want you to take a minute and pause this video and pray to God. Ask the Holy Spirit to reveal sin that needs to be repented of. Repent of that sin. Humble yourself before the Lord and exalt him in worship and gratitude for what he's done. So go ahead and pause and spend a few moments in prayer and repentance right now. Read this part from the passage once again. Verse 5. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but he emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. That's what these elements represent, the broken body and the shed blood of the humble servant Messiah who poured out his life in humility for our sakes so that we could be exalted with him. What a wonderful, wonderful memorial that we celebrate. So with a pure, clean heart and repentant spirit, go ahead and eat the bread and drink the juice. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for what you've accomplished through Jesus Christ. We thank you for the example of his humility and self-sacrifice. And Lord, we are struggling as a people with many things during the situation we find ourselves. And it's not just our church here or in our county or in our state, but it's around the globe. And I just pray, especially for us as American Christians right now, that we would be focused and intentional and just constantly reflecting on the humility of Christ's sacrifice, that characteristic would dominate our lives. It is easy in the midst of stress and frustration and anger to react selfishly and to care about yourself only. Father, may we not waste this time, but may you work in us and through us to make us more like Jesus and to be a blessing to our community through our meekness and our humility, our self-sacrificing, and our love for others. You have demonstrated that in such a powerful way, Lord. May we reflect even a bit of that and the power it would have in our community during this time. So, Father, forgive us of all our sins as we know you're faithful to do. Thank you for your love demonstrated through the humble sacrifice of Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
Calling, have you come to the end of yourself?